Hello again. I want to take a break here and just refocus something important that we might be losing sight of here because it's been a while since we introduced the normal distribution and the t-distribution, and it's kind of natural when we spend so much time working with them to fall into the mindset that they are perfect and describe everything, not least of which because, well, the name makes them sound pretty important and useful. But let's just understand here that even though we know a lot about the normal distribution, we can use it for a lot of things as a result of the central limit theorem, it's not necessarily the very best tool for every single job. For example, we saw in the homework situations where we wanted to describe the behaviors of responses on scales from 1 to 10 in terms of responses, in terms of responses to things like, I don't know, the pain chart at a doctor's office, where by nature, because the normal distribution and the t-distribution are both very continuous things that go on and on forever and ever and ever in every direction, we will necessarily get information about responses below 0, below 1 even, this is really all that matters, and above 10, as well as like in those gaps from say 7 to 8, where we really, as people reading the information, don't care about the probability of getting a mean response below 1 or above 10 or something like 7.222225, because we don't have frowny faces on the chart that describe what amount of pain that is. That's a necessary pitfall that we deal with when we're trying to describe a necessarily very discrete random variable with a necessarily very continuous distribution. Even though we do learn a lot about the distribution of our variable, and the distribution can be used to help us get there, we're still getting a lot of noise along with that useful data. And it's important to know that just because the normal distribution is useful, is helpful, it doesn't necessarily mean that it is always the very best. If you go further with probability and statistics, you may even see some of those other distributions that would be better suited for that kind of scenario. It just happens that, well, there are a whole lot of those, we can't get to every single one, and due to things like the central limit theorem, the normal distribution, the t-distribution, happen to be very helpful. They happen to be very widely applicable, but just know that even though they are widely applicable, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're the best tool for every single job. And by the way, the name normal distribution is often credited to, or at the very least, its origin is often seen as Francis Galton. And I mentioned him before in class, but it just feels so very appropriate to me that a incredibly unhelpful and presumptive nomenclature like normal distribution makes you think it's the most important and standard thing in the world would come from a pioneering member of the eugenics movement. So you may see, and I've probably mentioned it before, that in other contexts, the normal distribution is instead referred to as the Gaussian distribution, in honor of Friedrich Gauss, who spent a long time working with it as well. And I personally would rather honor a great mathematician than a pig-headed scientist. But a lot of people like the name normal distribution. In particular, our book does, so we still use it. Anyway, as I said, wanted to give a little bit more context here. Let's get back to business.